Hey, how you doing? This is RJ. So before I begin today, I just want to say that I did a video that I published yesterday, and it has some people concerned about my mental health. Now, I just want to say, first of all, thank you. But secondly, it's just a story. I'm a storyteller. That's all I am. I get into my stories. And every once in a while, about every 6 to 8 months, I like to shake things up around here so that they don't get too stale, and I like to do something odd. And so that's what I did with my video yesterday. And if you don't know what I'm talking about, I'll take a couple of those other odd videos that I did and link them at the end of this one. But more than a few people saw my last video that I did yesterday as a little bit dark. So to even that out, I'm going to do a more positive video today. And I'm going to talk about why ComicsGate will win in the end. Or at the very least, the mindset behind ComicsGate will win in the end, where we get these progressive, quote-unquote progressive people out of comics, and we return simply to good storytelling. And briefly on that note, there is a link in the description for my coming graphic novel, which is focusing on a good story. I think the tentative plan right now is that we will be launching around the 15th of January, because at the very least, I want to have 20 pages of the art done for the book by the time we launch, as well as a number of the pinup posters that we are going to have for perks. And Renzo is working furiously, and he assures me that we will meet that deadline. I also have at least 3 of the pinup posters ready to go. I'm having a little trouble finding someone to do a map, because I want to do a perk where I have a map of the city where this all takes place in my story, but I can't really find someone. Anyways, but the link is in the description for my coming graphic novel. If you wish to go to the coming soon page, you can leave your email address, and if you do, you will be informed when the project goes live, and you will receive a free pinup poster if you later decide to order the book. And as I had tweeted out yesterday, along with my Friday update of my graphic novel, I said, the time for indie comics is now. And I truly believe that, because I truly believe that we are going to take the comic industry back from these quote-unquote progressive people who have taken it over. So what I'm going to do is to present to you my hypothesis, because that's really what it is. And I would like you to put in the comments whether or not you think this hypothesis is true. And I think this hypothesis not only stands for comics, but also for tabletop games, also for board games, also for video games, and a whole lot of other things that you would find typically within your comic shop. And my hypothesis is this. I would say that the majority of comic readers are introverts. And the problem that we have right now is the majority of the people running comics, and at the very least a small majority of the people who are producing comics for those main industries, are all extroverts. And this is where the disconnect comes from, and this is why we don't get a good product. Now, very briefly, for those people who are not familiar with these terms, what is an introvert and what is an extrovert? So I'll give you the sort of pop culture definition for these terms. An introvert is someone who is not terribly comfortable with social situations, but really the place where they find comfort is in being alone, is in being by themselves. This is where they recharge. This is where they feel the most comfortable. And on the other hand, extroverts are people who are uncomfortable being alone and who find comfort in being with a social group. And this is where they recharge. This is where they find their strength. Or to put it another way, an introvert finds social situations as work and finds alone situations as leisure, whereas an extrovert finds alone situations as work and social situations as leisure. And as I said, I think the majority of the people who read comic books are introverts. Now, that's not saying that if you're an extrovert, you're not a real comic fan. I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying you're in the minority. And to talk about this, I'm going to do something I usually don't do. I'm just going to give you some personal experiences of my own over the last 30 years within comic shops and see if you agree with them or not. See if you have experienced these things or not, because I am an introvert. And I would say that when I go into a comic shop, what typically happens is I spend about 5 minutes looking at the new stuff. I might ask the guy behind the counter if something has come in very briefly, and then I go to the backstock. And usually I spend about 45 minutes in the backstock looking for something to read, looking for something to add to my collection. That 45 minutes is spent in silence. Maybe someone comes over and says, "Can I help you find anything?" once, and then if you say no, they leave you alone and you're there just looking through comics. That's my experience, typically. And I think that time of being alone, that time of looking through the backstock, that is time an introvert actually enjoys. Now that's what I would call my ideal trip to the comic store. Now, I want to give you a picture of 2 different comic stores that I have access to right now. And one of these comic stores is a place that's really neat and tidy. All the long boxes are in order. All the comics in the long boxes are in order. They're all bagged and boarded. They all have a price tag on the front, and when you get up to the counter, that price tag is the price that you pay. The entire store is very bright and well lit. There are comfortable areas for sitting and everything else that you might find in a normal store. That's store number one. Store number two is a hole in the wall. And this hole in the wall is fairly dark and dingy. We have long boxes strewn all over the place. Comics are not in order. If you're looking through things, half of them are not in bags. Even if they are, the guy typically takes them off when he gives them to you. And if they have a price tag on them, he'll look on his computer to see if the price has gone up since he last put a price tag on it, and you're going to pay whatever the higher price is. But which one of these stores do I go to? Well, I go to the dingy hole in the wall. That's the store I typically go to every week. Now, why would I do that? Because the people who have owned this really nice comic store for the last 30 years, they don't, for some reason, understand how comic readers actually work. They don't know that the majority of comic readers are introverts. These people just get on my nerves so much. I want to go over and look through the Conan and find something that I don't own. And they keep on bothering me. Can I help you with something? Can I get this for you? You know, we have this. You could come over and look at that. And I'm thinking to myself, leave me alone. Leave me alone. I just want a book. I just want to look for my book. Leave me alone. That's at best. At worst, the female of the two comes over and says, would you like to see my dog? I have a new toy dog. Come on, pet my dog. What do you mean you don't like animals? What kind of person doesn't like animals? And I'm sitting there going in my head, shut up, lady. Go away. I'm trying to look for a book that I want to find. I don't want to talk to you. That's not the reason I came in here. And by the way, I like animals just fine, but they belong on a farm, not in a comic store. And so, although store number one is really nice and things are well organized and I probably get a better deal there, I don't go there. Why? Because the guy at store number two, where everything is dark and dingy and out of order, he knows how to deal with people who come into a comic shop. Typically, he'll say hello to you, ask you if you want anything or if he can help you with anything. If you say no, he leaves you alone. If you want to talk about something, he knows exactly what you want to talk about and he doesn't move out of that category. If you want to talk about magic, he'll talk about magic. If you want to talk about D&D, he'll talk about D&D. If you want to talk about comics, he'll talk about comics. He typically does not move out of the comfort area of the person who is actually talking to him and who starts this conversation. This is the way that you deal with people in a comic shop. Why? Because the majority of people are introverts, and those people have a comfort zone, and they don't like to move out of this comfort zone, and so he knows this, and he deals with this very well, and so I go to his store. Now I want to extend this just for a little bit and talk about introverts and extroverts for a second on their own. Now, if you're an introvert, tell me whether or not you've ever ran across this situation. You've gotten to a place where you're in a social situation, okay? Someone has a party or there's a wedding or something like that and you feel socially obligated to go there or some such thing. And when you're there, you're a wallflower. You're just doing your own thing. But at some point, you're looking at the people who are all extroverts and you're saying to yourself, well, they're a bit shallow and vapid, but they do their own thing. I'm going to leave them alone. And then at some point, you kind of want to leave. So you just try to slink out the back. And then someone grabs you and say, no, 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 you can't leave. And you go, why not? And they say, well, you got to say goodbye to everybody. You got to do this and you got to do that. And I'm thinking in my head, no, I don't. I don't have to go through some social dance in order to get out of here. If I want to leave, I want to leave, and I'm going to do that. Or the worst situation that could occur is that you're sitting there by yourself, and one of these extroverts comes over and says, come on, you got to join in with the rest of us. And I'm like, no, no, I don't. No, I'm good here. And they think, no, you're just shy. Come on over. You really will enjoy it when you get over here and do all this with us, because that's what they truly believe. They believe that you are just shy, that there is something that is inhibiting you from actually enjoying yourself, and they don't actually think you're enjoying yourself over there by yourself. Well, you might not be, but at the very least, you're enjoying yourself more than if you're over in the thick of things with the rest of them. But they won't take no for an answer. And they get you to come over to this part of the party or whatever it is, and they try to include you, and it's the most uncomfortable thing in the world. And you do not want to be there. You do not have fun. And this ensures the fact that the next time this comes up, you're not going to go. And the point is that extroverts don't understand introverts. And that's the problem. Introverts understand very well what extroverts are. They say to themselves, okay, I know that I'm this way, and I know that they are that way. Personally, I look at most extroverts and I say, yeah, you're a bit shallow and vapid, but I understand that that's how you are. Therefore, you go ahead and do that. I'm okay with that. Just leave me alone. But the thing is that that comes from a point where we are actually understanding our own thoughts. And you can do that as an introvert because you have time alone with your own thoughts. And therefore you understand this. But the extroverts, they don't like time alone with their own thoughts. They actually find that a bit disturbing. And therefore they don't understand that there's anybody else but them. They don't understand that other people can exist in a different way. They simply think that their way is the only way. And therefore you, as a person who is an introvert, you have something wrong with you. Typically, they hide it behind the word shy. They say, well, you're just shy. You just need to be coaxed out of your shell. No. I'm good where I am. But they won't take that no for an answer. And the reason they won't take that no for an answer, again, is because they think there's something wrong with you. They think you're broken. They think you have some kind of defect that makes you unable to do what normal people do. Now, very briefly, the thing is that within North America, I would say the majority of people are extroverts, not introverts. So to some degree, you can see why extroverts actually think this. Besides the fact they don't actually spend a whole lot of time thinking about anything like this, they typically see the majority of people as being like themselves. By the way, just as an aside, I think this is why Japan is the way that it is and why manga sells so well in Japan. I would say in Japan, the majority of people are introverts. And this is why the comic genre actually is taking off there. Because the comic genre actually needs introverts. It is something that takes a little more effort to actually get into. It takes a little bit of introspective. It takes a little bit of understanding your own self and your own thoughts in order to look at these thoughts that are down on the page and connect them all together. And the thing is that I would say Japan is more of an introvert culture because it's a shame culture, whereas North America is more of a guilt culture. Whereas in Japan, in a shame culture, someone is always pointing at you and saying, you've done something wrong. And therefore, that typically makes people retreat into their own shell more. And that's why, again, I would say there is a majority of people there that are introverts. And this is why, one of the reasons why, anyways, manga sells so well. And this is also one of the reasons why, no matter how much North American companies try, they're never going to be able to recreate the success of manga in North America, because we have a different kind of people here. Now, as I said, I think that comics are actually a medium which attracts the introvert. It is a medium, certainly, that requires a little bit more effort than your normal sit down and watch a television show, sit down and watch a movie. You know, you could just let those things wash over you. But with a comic book, you're actually participating to some extent. And that participation does, as I indicated, it does have an element wherein you're engaging with it in a way that you can understand your own thoughts as separate from you. And that's what you're looking at on the page. Typically, you're looking at words and thoughts that are separate from the character themselves. And I think that, again, introverts really interact with this a lot easier than extroverts do. And this is where we get into the problem. Because again, the problem is that these extroverts are the people that are now in control of producing comics. And they simply don't understand not only the medium, but they don't understand the typical person who picks up a comic book and enjoys to read it. But before I get into that, just another quick aside. I would say this dynamic between extrovert and introvert is also the reason why comics and video games and tabletop games and all these other kinds of fantasy science fiction mediums are attracting these quote-unquote progressive people so that they want to take them over. Why? Because, again, typically, your progressive ideology comes out of a socialist communist mindset. And if you look at the manuals of socialist communist ideology and how they typically try to indoctrinate people and bring them into their way of thinking, they start over and over again at a point that says, start with the people you consider broken. Start with the people that are social misfits. Those are the people you need to target first. You need to bring them into the fold. They become your primary foot soldiers. And that's the thing. You have these people who are in control. You have these people who are quote-unquote progressives. The majority of them are extroverts, and they look at us as introverts as broken. They look at us as if there is something wrong with us. Therefore, they have been taught to target us, and they think that they will target us and convert us to their way of thinking. Unfortunately, they don't understand the simple fact that no, we're not broken. We simply view the world in a different way than you. We're just on a different wavelength. That doesn't mean we're broken. But according to them, again, because they're extroverts, they can't see that. All they see when they look at us is someone who is broken, someone who needs to be fixed. Or at the very least, someone who they can exploit because they're in a weak position. And that's exactly what quote-unquote progressivism seeks to do at every turn. But again, we're not broken. There's nothing wrong with us. I would say that for most introverts, we look at extroverts and sort of chuckle and go, yeah, you think we're broken? Really? Honestly? Yeah, okay. But I want to look specifically at comics and how this translates into a non-ability for these extroverts to actually get comics right. Now, I would say one of the basic earmarks of understanding that these extroverts are now in control of comics, and have been so for a little while now, is the fact that you no longer see thought bubbles anywhere. They have been erased from how you currently make comics. And the thing is that, of course, they don't have thought bubbles, because if the majority of people writing these or producing these are extroverts, they don't understand how to interact with their own thoughts. And they certainly can't understand how to put that down on a page with another character. Because the narration boxes that they have right now, narration is not the same as thought. It's not a thought bubble. Narration is something completely different. I don't go around in my normal life with a narration playing in my head about what I'm about to do or what's going to happen. No, I think. And my thoughts typically look a lot more like thought bubbles than they do the narration boxes that you see in current comics. And again, I would say this is because the majority of people producing and writing comics, they don't understand how to interact even with their own thoughts, therefore they can't put this down on a page. Let's look at something else that is adjacent to comics. If you look at comic cons. Now, if you went to a comic con a long time ago, you're simply looking at a very large comic shop with a couple of extra things here and there. And you would spend your time going through long boxes and finding what you wanted. Today, typically, it's hard to find any comics there at all. And one of the things that they try to push at Marvel over and over again, and they connect it with comic cons and all these other kinds of gatherings that they're always pushing themselves into, is cosplay. And this is a typical example of what I'm talking about. I would say the majority, the vast majority of people who do any kind of cosplaying, they're extroverts. They're not your typical introvert comic reader, not in any way, shape, or form. And the ones that are all over Marvel, the ones that are producing podcasts about cosplay and are cosplaying at every little convention and thing that they can get to, these people are not only extroverts, but they are extroverts on steroids. Their cosplay is an extension of, hey, look at me! You gotta look at me over here! That is the last thing an introvert wants. Even if their cosplay is really, really good, and I think, wow, you put a lot of work into that, and that really shows, that looks spectacular, but at the same time, there's part of me going, yeah, you could never, ever get me to do that. Not in a million years. No, that's okay. I'm staying over here with the boxes full of comics. You stay over there. And this mindset of these extroverts, it just plays into how they think comics should be produced. And it makes them fall into these traps, where they believe things that are basically nonsense. If you look at Marvel and its declaration about a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, that they were going to be a lifestyle brand. Now, I went over this in many different videos. But the thing is that they don't understand what a lifestyle brand is. Or if they do, they're trying to make it into something else, or they mean something else. Because a lifestyle brand is targeted towards a subculture. That's the only way that it works. And they're trying to say, look, we have this lifestyle brand. We're turning Marvel into a lifestyle brand, but at the same time they're saying, and we want it to appeal to everyone. I'm sorry, but if you're making it appeal to everyone, you're not actually using the marketing strategy of lifestyle branding. Because, as I said, lifestyle branding works upon a subculture. That's the only way that it actually works, because the advertisers tap into a hidden language that the people in this subculture understand. And so they use this hidden language to appeal to them. They're saying, look, we understand the way you think, we understand what you do, and we can show you that we understand that by using the language that only you know and your subculture knows, and we're using that to try to sell you this product. And you'll buy our product because you understand we're supporting your subculture. And again, as I said, Marvel simply does not understand this. They're trying to do that, but take it into the mainstream. That does not work in any way, shape, or form. But that does point to a very interesting thing about comics, that it is a subculture, and this is why it attracts introverts to some extent. Because that subculture, again, has its own language, and it's a language that introverts are actually comfortable with. Because that's the thing, introverts have a limited amount of social interaction that they feel comfortable with, and therefore they stay within those limits. And when you know those limits, like the subculture of comic books, then you can very easily stay within those limits. And this is what you need to appeal to if you're actually appealing to people who are the majority of comic buyers. And the thing is, the icing on the cake about Marvel not understanding how this actually works is a mindset, again, that I went over in a couple of videos probably about a year ago, year and a half ago, where you had all these statements coming out from Marvel, these people who work for Marvel and are controlling the comic production. They had this weird mindset in the back of their heads that, look, we understand that these comics are not selling really well now, but we think that there's this massive audience out there just waiting to snatch these things up, and all we have to do is find a way to connect with them. That's why they were doing all of these ridiculous things that had nothing really to do with comic books. Things like cooking shows, and fashion shows, and again, cosplay, and all these other things. They were trying to connect with this audience, this phantom audience that they thought was out there that was going to eat up these comic books and have them selling like hotcakes. And again, that points to the fact that they believe two very specific things. One, either they can take the introverts and convert them into extroverts because there's something wrong with you and we just need to fix you, or they believe that they can take a medium like comics, which is typically built for introverts, and sell it to extroverts. And again, neither of those things is going to work for you. And so I come back to my original thesis. I would say that because the majority of comic readers are introverts, this is why Comicsgate and the mindset behind Comicsgate will win. Because we are a subculture. And not only do we understand how comics work, the history of comics, but we understand how this subculture works. We understand how the social construct that we have created within this subculture is limited. And we also understand that the people who make up this subculture have a limited number of social interactions that they're comfortable with. And we work within that framework. And we say, yeah, that's okay, that's fine. I understand that. I'm like you. I am the same way. And because I understand this social system that we have within the subculture, I am going to be able to appeal to you even more. And in addition to that, we typically understand how an introvert interacts with the idea of a hero. And this brings it back to what I'm always talking about. If we go back to the very, very early definition of hero within Western civilization, if we go back to the Greeks and we look at this definition of hero, one of the historical ideas that brought this into existence into our language was the fact that you would have these Greek city-states and they would typically go to war with each other. And you'd have two armies facing off and the generals would get together and say, look, instead of having each of our armies fight and everybody die, you pick the best out of your warriors and I'll pick the best out of mine, and they are going to be the ones who fight, and that's it. And if you win, you win, and we are going to be your servants. And if we win, we win, and you are our servants. And this person that was picked, this person that was the elite, this was their hero. And all of the hopes and dreams of their entire nation was pinned upon them because they had to win, and if they didn't win, their entire nation would be in servitude. This is one of the origins of the idea of hero within Greek civilization. But the thing is that this hero, this person who was elite, he was a standalone person. No one else was fighting with him, and he had this great pressure upon him, and he had to be, to some degree, alone, because he was extraordinary. And it is this loneliness, this extraordinary loneliness, that we have carried on with us in the idea of hero up until this day. This is the thing that lets introverts connect with the idea of hero. And I would say everybody wants to be a hero. Everybody has this heroic nature within them. It's part of human nature, so you want to connect with it, but it allows us introverts to connect with this idea of hero and therefore bring it out within ourselves. It is that loneliness of an extraordinary life that gives us the key that allows us to access this idea so easily. And again, this brings us back to the reason why mainstream comics are going to fail and why movements like Comicsgate will actually win. Because, to extend the analogy, they are the invading force. They are coming onto our territory and trying to take over what is ours. But the thing is, they don't understand the lay of the land. They don't understand how the territory works underneath their feet. And that is the only advantage that we need. That is the advantage that we press. And that is the advantage that will allow us to drive these invaders out of a territory that belongs to us. So, if I've given you anything new to think about, hit like, hit the shield in the lower right-hand corner of your screen to subscribe, and leave me a comment. Tell me what you think about all this. And don't forget, the link is in the description for the coming soon page for my graphic novel, which I am scheduling to come out in mid-January, so you only have a limited amount of time to leave your address on the coming soon page so that you can receive your exclusive free pinup poster if you decide to order the book when the project goes live. All right. I'll see you later. Bye.